Yes, well, very good morning to all, and welcome to this unique live technical discussion series. Today we are going to focus on important design and construction parameters for industrial PEB structures at a tender stage. And we'll be having Dr. Abhay Gupta with us shortly. So whenever we talk about PEB structures, I believe that the tender stage is very much important, because this is the stage where we will define the design parameters, or say construction parameters, which will be followed for the entire project cycle. So we will be discussing today about certain important parameters related to design and construction for industrial PEB structures. So we launched a registration form, there are many interesting discussion points which have been suggested by the participants. So we have picked up few points for the discussion today, which we'll be taking up in the subsequent discussion. Okay, so once again, very good morning to all, and welcome to this unique live technical discussion. Yes, good morning. Good morning, Jatin. Okay, and Dr. Abhay Gupta has just joined, so let us welcome him. Yes, yeah. Good morning and welcome, Dr. Abhay Gupta. How are you?
Hi, good morning, everybody. I hope everyone is safe at home and taking good care of everybody in the family. So just be safe from Corona, this second wave, and enjoy life in a restricted manner. Good time to stay at home and learn many good things. So this is one of them.
Right. Yeah, so people are joining. Good morning, Pritesh. Good morning, Abhishek Singh. So Abhishek Singh has...
Abhishek has posted many queries, and I know he's quite a curious person.
Yes. So in previous talk also, he suggested many important points related to PEB structure. Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. So tender stage is very important, right, when we talk about industrial PEB structures, right?
Tender stage is something which basically drives the entire project.
Right.
Not only execution, not only performance, but the economics also are all linked to the tender stage. How good we are at defining the parameters at tender stage makes life of everybody very easy.
Yes.
Any open-ended point leads to a lot of confusion and sometimes dispute, debate also. So if a tender stage specification, including the construction parameters, is properly framed, agreed, everything, then everybody is happy.
Right.
For the information of all, because the audience must be a mix of design engineers, PEB marketing people, clients also. So for information of all, PEB per se, it is pre-engineered building. Now the name says pre-engineered means the impression is something which is engineered before. Let me tell you that everything which is constructed is engineered before.
Yes.
Nothing is made. A small thing, if I talk of this mask, this is also engineered first. A design is made, then it is cut. So everything is pre-engineered. Actually, prefabricated is something. The term pre-engineered started long back in some era where custom-made, off-the-shelf things were to be given. Off-the-shelf building. In Europe, in America, it is still a culture that many of the building components are available off-the-shelf. You go to a home shop, a big home shop. Big means they run like areas in acre. Big home shops are there. And you go there and you just choose, you want a particular type of house, a particular type of shed. And you just choose from the list and every component of that is ready available. You just pick that in a truck, it comes to your place on your land and assembled. That's all. That is the real pre-engineered building.
Right.
But now what we do is a customized pre-engineered building, where more is prefabrication. Rather than on-site construction, it is off-site construction. That is the basic difference. The pre-engineering is nowadays being used in the world. So whatever customization we do, it is first the entire thing is planned and then it is prefabricated. On-site, it is only assembled. Completely knocked down, CKD condition. That's a very important term. So whatever is constructed is a completely knocked down condition, CKD. It is brought in trucks, trailers, and is assembled with the help of nuts and bolts. No welding on site is allowed. Allowed in the sense, there's no legal complication. Allowed means you can't have that control of the quality on site. So the basic objective of delivering a quality product in short time, that is defeated if someone allows the on-site welding. So on tender stage, this point should be very well made clear that no on-site welding shall be allowed. Very important. Under any circumstances, once you adhere to it, once you make it very strictly implemented, then automatically the production team takes care of it. There will be double, triple check that nothing is wrong supplied on the site. Even the consultant, engineers involved, the client, they are all restricted. They understand that since on site there is no welding to be done, they do not try to change anything. There is no revision in the project. That is another big plus point of this. So we'll be talking mainly about the customized prefabricated structures. When say industrial PEB structures, I'm just excluding those multi-story buildings as of now. We are talking of the industrial structures. In industrial multi-story may be there. There may be mezzanines inside a shed, but primarily a portal frame structure, a single portal or multiple portal with intermediate horizontal floor levels. But not, I'm just excluding the multi-story building because their design parameters are a little different than this. So we'll be restricting to the industrial PEB structures. The format of specification, the format of the tender should be very, very exhaustive. You should put as much things as possible. Whatever components are there in the building, all those components should be included in a general specification document. Then there should be a separate form in which what is applicable to this project and what is not applicable should be mentioned. For example, I give you, industrial buildings may need insulation. So insulation specifications may be included in the general specification document. Now there may be variety of insulation. So you may have insulation type 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, while that is a general applicable to all, if required, then there can be a separate format, an Excel sheet, which is a customized specification for this building, particular building, wherein you can say insulation heading is there, no insulation either. So that insulation clause from the general specification is ignored. Or type 1 insulation or 2 insulation or 3 insulation. Then you have defined those insulation. Or there may be a change, so you may include one more unit. So this is just one example of that specification. So there should be a general specification document and there should be one specific specifications applied to that building. I say insulation hai ya nahi hai, yes or no? If I say no, then nothing. If I say yes, the next question will be which one? So then type 1. So the vendor, PEB vendor or insulation supplier may check what is the description of type 1 in the detailed specification document. This is how we make the things comprehensive and convenient for everybody. I'll show you one document of this kind, a sample. This is just a sample. I should start sharing the screen, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. I'm sharing the screen and this document. So whether this Word document is visible?
Yes, Word document is visible now. Tender notice.
Start with a tender notice. I hope it is visible to all the participants also, all the audience also. So this is a tender notice which specifies the building description with an approximate cost and the qualification criteria. Like, we are inviting from pre-engineered steel building manufacturing firms of repute who have successfully executed similar nature of single work of not less than this much value. This is a pre-qualification. Then the tender document can be obtained from this. This is general information about the tender. Who is the client? What is the name of the work? What is the period of completion and date of receipt and opening? General information of the tender notice, as in case of everything else. Now the description of building. Now, the building description has got some important things, and it is mentioned as per drawings. Because everything from the drawing you cannot write here. I'll show you another Excel sheet customized for this particular building. But here in the general specification, we'll say these things to be taken from the drawings. So a set of tender drawings should always be attached. Set of tender drawings should always be attached, which indicates clearly the dimensions, plan dimensions, out to out of the steel columns, the height at the eaves, which is a clear height at the eaves inside. Clear height at the eaves inside. How many bays are there? Number of bays. The erection level and reference levels. Those levels should be properly marked. If there are crane details should be there. So they all should be in the drawing. What are those drawings which are enclosed? Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the drawing number, sheet number, and all that will come here. So they form the tender document. Time and performance schedule. These dates are important. Then schedule of completion. These are not technical points, but they are important from the tender point of view. It's a completely bifurcated schedule. In some project, there may be some more additional milestones which may be added here. What is the period of contract, which is completion period plus 2 months? Now it depends. Individual consultant may make it 2 months, 3 months, 1 month. It is okay. So after the completion, that the contract still continues for some more time. Price should be quoted for supply and erection separately. Okay. Because there are two different jobs, and many pre-engineered building vendors, they outsource the erection to an agency. And there are some taxations also different, so quote them separately. Sometimes, in very rare cases, but there are cases, client says, you just supply, erection we will take care. It also happens like that. Though I don't consider that to be a good practice, but it is there. Payment term, schedule of payment, the people may quote differently. This is just a general, what normally the PEB industry is following, but this is not a point of discussion for us today. Liquidated damages should be charged. This should be there. An incentive clause should also be there in the tender. If somebody is doing a good work, give them reward. If not delivering in time, there should be a penalty. Scope of work. This is general scope of work, which is designing, supplying, erecting all the components. Built up steel members and connections for columns and rafters, cold rolled members for purlin runners, bracing system for transfer of lateral load to ground, and effectively brace the compression flange of the column. There are two bracing systems. One is for the lateral loads, another is for maintaining the shape of this section. Okay. Then sheets, roof sheets, cladding sheets, what type, what color, they'll be there. Rainwater gutters and downtake pipes, these are important components. Framed opening for all kind of rolling shutters, doors and windows, ventilators. Foundation bolts for steel buildings, whether they are in the scope or not, that should be very clearly specified. Sometimes the foundation bolts are kept in the scope of the client itself or the civil contractor because of the time lag sometimes. It all depends. It may be either way. No worries. Checkered plates, if there are steel staircases. Then a special scope. Some buildings need some special requirements. Now the process consultant knows it. What kind of process is going to happen in that building? What kind of the industry it is? Whether it is a clean room, it is a pharma, it is plastic extrusion, it is something where dust proofing is required, whatever. So any kind of special requirement should be mentioned here. And how to achieve, that should be made very clear that this is the requirement. Particularly when the building is finished, completely handed over, that time when you see the line level alignments are not good on the edges, the flashings and trims are not properly fixed, and these lead to the problems in the future. So very carefully, the specification should be mentioned about the flashings, trims, packing of the building, complete leak proof or whatever. All those things should be very clearly specified, and during meeting, they should be discussed well with the vendors. So no confusion of any kind. If there are gantry girders, then with the gantry girder, what capacity and other things, very specifically the gantry girder details should be given, two wheel, four wheel, double girder, single girder, all those kind of things should be clearly defined. They will be in the customized scope. Walkway will be there with the railing. How many walkways are required, where? Staircase will be required going up to the gantry level. Depending on the length of the building, one number, two number, or even more, there may be. Underdeck insulation, whether applicable or not. And then details of that will be there. Provision for future expansion. This is very important. If there is any kind of future expansion envisaged in the project, it should be specified. Turbo vents. Turbo vents, nowadays there are several varieties available, so you should be very, very good in specifying the turbo vent. Or if you want the vendor to design for a certain number of air changes, you should specify that the number of turbo vents should comply to so many number of air changes. And then calculation should be submitted by vendor, which should be approved by the consultant. That may affect the costing depending on the type of the turbo vent which is going to be used. So the type of turbo vent and number of air changes required, they are related. It can be either the consultant himself puts that or leave it to the vendor. But leaving to the vendor may sometimes lead to a debate. Better that consultant specifies in the tender. Polycarbonate sheets or FRP sheets. Nowadays, nobody uses FRP sheets for light inside the shed. Polycarbonate sheets are used. Whether the polycarbonate sheets are required on the roof or on the sidewall, what thickness, what category, what transparency is required, painting on all the members, whether the purlins and side runners, the girds are required to be galvanized. If they are to be required galvanized, then the GSM has to be specified. And this GSM is something which should be very carefully checked. For all the vendors, I am saying, this GSM is a big issue. There should be a proper method to check this GSM of the galvanization on the secondary members. This is one of the major debate. We specify 275 GM and we get 150 GSM. It is a general observation. Sometimes, because the vendor himself sometimes is not very well aware that what kind of the GSM has been supplied. This GSM, whatever GSM is specified, it is on each face of the galvanized member, not on the both sides. Means on both sides separately. If I am specifying 275 GSM, 275 GSM on each face of that member. It's not the half on this and half on that. No. Whether puff panels are to be used. So if puff panels are there, as specified in the drawing, either in the drawing, all specifications are given, or the specifications are mentioned here. But regarding the puff panel, their thickness, the density, their profile, everything should be clearly mentioned. Steel staircase with the railing will be there. Nothing more about the staircases as far as design, whether the railing is there, what kind of tread is required, whether checkered plate tread is there or you want to put some stone or whatever. Cage ladder. Cage ladders are required to go to the roof. Number of cage ladders would depend on the size of the building. There may be one, there may be two, and even sometime more, depending on the length of the building. So cage ladder location should be shown on the drawing. This cage ladder should be coming up to the 1 meter above the ground floor minimum, so that a person standing can climb up comfortably. Okay. and it should be lockable from the bottom, means no unauthorized person entry should be there. So those kind of things can be mentioned, that a secured cage labor. Cable train services, if there are cable trays to be run in the plant, in the industry, the cable tray support structure, who is going to provide, it is in whose scope, whether it is in the scope of PEB or it is in the scope of the cable supplier. It should be very clearly specified what kind of loading is to be considered. Nowadays, there are several precast building plants are there in the construction, and those precast plants need much more different kind of attachments on the side columns. So other than cable trays, you may have many more attachments which should be very clearly specified in the drawings and in the specifications. Their loading also. Loading is very, very important. Framed openings, what kind of framed openings? Lowers. Now these lowers are very important and costly items. So their specification should be well drafted in the specification. There may be more items. I'm not saying this is a complete leap, I'm just giving you an example. That this kind of a document which will enlist everything of the pre-engineered building. Fasteners would be there. I think fasteners are not there here. But fastener type, whether they are black, MS black fasteners, or you want to use bolts will be, anchor bolts will be MS, or the other fasteners would be GI fasteners or normal height and style, those should be. Now these conditions of contract, they are the general conditions of contract which are applicable to every building. They do not change. The important one is, it's a lump sum contract. Means, this is not based on the item rate. The building specifications are well defined and the vendor will calculate the total bill of quantity and work out a cost and then give a quotation of a lump sum price. Any change in the specification will change this lump sum price. Any deviation. So deviations are there. Deviations are unavoidable sometimes. So price for deviation should be separately quoted. So the whatever is building is specified, that should be a lump sum value. And over and above, deviation prices should be quoted separately. I'll show you that also. Design should conform to the design norms specified in this tender. Where silent, references shall be made to these things. Basically, in the tender, we'll specify the code. Which code is to be used for the design. If anything is not given in that code, then which other codes can be referred, that list should be given here. Like we have given, we generally prefer IS code design. So our tenders will include IS code design only, IS 800, IS 875, all those codes. And then if something is not available in that Indian code, then we will say use AISC code. Specialist literature on the board, there is a freedom to use specialist recognized literature, established literature on the subject, which is published, and not only published recently, but published old and tried by the people. Maybe in other country codes are there, those practices. So with the sufficient document support, you can use any international practice, any international practice. It's not prohibited if it is not available in Indian code. If there is anything available better than Indian code, it is, that too also can be used, but nothing inferior than the Indian code. Submission of proper design on time is the responsibility of PEB supplier. Okay, that's a sales point. Price to remain firm. Okay, so period of contract and all those, the price will remain firm for this period. Sufficiency of price, it includes all these things. Assignments and subletting. Okay, safety. Safety clauses should be there. On PEB sites, this is a very, very important and matter of concern. Very important. Because PEB labor works at a height with small, thin members. And there are all chances of any kind of mishappening occurring there. So everybody, when you quote for a PEB project, when you quote for an industrial project, you must include the cost of the safety in that. There should be a safety supervisor. There should be proper safety equipments, harness, cap, helmet, all those things, the safety shoes. Every staff should be using that. Because the cost of one life is much more than altogether all these things. One life. Let me make it very clear. So never ever ignore the safety in your किसी भी साइट पे, छोटी बड़ी कैसी भी हो, एंड everyone which is associated, client, consultant, or the vendor, or the erection contractor, never ignore the safety for any reason. आपको काम बंद करना पड़े एक दिन दो दिन, it's okay. But this is something very very important. Some other conditions are there. The erection of building shall be done under the supervision of an experienced engineer from PEB supplier. This is sometimes ignored. So when it is mentioned in the tender, the engineer, the consultant, or the client can certainly say if experienced engineer is not there, then erection cannot happen. And any delay because of that will be the responsibility of the PEB supplier. Okay. Foundation bolt shall be checked and certified by PEB supplier. This is very, very important. Because the foundation bolts are, they may be supplied by the PEB supplier, PEB vendor, but they are fixed on site in the concrete pedestal by the civil contractor. And civil contractors or their staff is not very well trained always. There's a variety. We have got very good quality civil contractors, right from L&T to we've got some local contractors working in the industry. And let me tell you, out of the total number of projects, more than 60% projects are being done by those small civil contractors who have no or much less concern about few millimeters here or there. For them, millimeters do not matter. But for PEB people, millimeters matter. So your engineer should be there. Make sure that all the bolts are fixed at the proper place so that your fabrication drawings are correctly made. So that your fabrication is correctly done, so that you don't need to do any kind of site correction. Very, very important. While closure, the warranty, these things should be there. And then insurance clause is there as per the law. These are the general conditions of the tender. Now comes the general technical specification. Here, technical specification of everything is mentioned. आपको मटेरियल कौन से मैन्युफैक्चरर का लेना है, किस ग्रेड का लेना है, वेल्डिंग कैसे करनी है, आइदर वेल्डिंग हैज टू बी एज पर IS 816 और एज पर द AWS, इट शुड सैटिस्फाई, इट शुड बी वेरी क्लियरली मेंशन. नाउ IS कोड अलाउज बोथ साइड इंटरमीडिएट वेल्डिंग. मेनी पीपल माइट नॉट बी नोइंग दिस. मोस्ट ऑफ अस कंसीडर दैट वन साइड कंटीन्यूअस वेल्डिंग इज गुड इनफ. इवन आई हैव सीन मेनी पीपल नॉट डूइंग इवन द इंटरमीडिएट वेल्डिंग ऑन द अदर साइड. They just do a stitch at the place where there's a plate joint. It's not okay. It's not correct. In my opinion, it is not a correct practice. You may go for an intermittent welding, stitch welding on either side, provided it is supported by a proper design calculation. It is allowed in the code. But if you are doing a continuous welding on one side using your automatic saw welding machine, okay. The other side should have the stitch welding. If not more, then a 50 mm stitch weld at every 1 meter should be there. It is there. Cold form members, whatever is the galvanization material of the, you can also specify the make. That make is already here. Okay. You may add or delete some more. Recently, there was a circular from ministry that there is nothing like primary or secondary. I don't know. It was primarily for the reinforcement, but I think the same kind of an opinion should be there for the structural steel as well. Ministry doesn't say anything primary, secondary. I don't know what is the further debate or discussion on that. But generally, there are two types of the steel manufacturing process. One who make from the basic raw material and one who do from the recirculating steel. Sheeting, proper specification of the sheets are there. All types of sheets specifications would be there. Purlins and runners. Fasteners specifications are there. What kind of fasteners? Make are also specified. Nuts and bolts. Then about the other things, accessories, paint, rainwater gutter, underdeck insulation specifications. Dust-free measures. Puff panels, sag rod and nut bolts. Nowadays, in place of sag rod, sag angles are also being used, which is a good improvement on the practice. Sag rods do not really perform well. sometimes sag angles are good. Sample of what all material needed, flashing, deck sheet, various types of deck sheets are there. And nowadays, good amount of deck sheet with a longer span permitted are also there. You can use them. So all those specifications should come here. About the bracings, Indian code does not allow the use of the rod bracing. But international practice allows the rod bracing as well as the wire rope bracing also. But there is a requirement which is given in the footnote, which we are unable to follow. At all my sites so far, 100%, where rod bracings have been used, I have invariably seen them sagging, bending, and not taut. They are not tight. So if they are not tight, they are not functional. Bracings are a very important component of an industrial building, which help the lateral wind force to be transferred, earthquake force to be transferred. Now, if the bracings are not tight, absolutely tight, they cannot transfer. They cannot be active. So, friends, do not use rod bracing in any major industrial structure. Minor ones, very small ones, 3 meter height, you may go. Just some small shelters, that is okay. Small shelters, kiosk, booth, huts, it's okay. But not for the major industrial sheds. Never use rod bracings. Always go for pipe angles. Nowadays, very good pipes are available. Very good. Economical, very efficient. So you can use them. Coming to the design. So this general specification contains the specification about the design also. And here we mention that all the design should be as per the relevant BIS code unless otherwise specified. For designs where BIS is silent, other code of practices may be referred. Very clear. The frame shall be analyzed. Now, this is very, very important. The frame shall be analyzed along with RCC columns. The PB steel column is fixed or pinned, whatever, at the top of an RCC pedestal, and that RCC pedestal goes down up to the foundation. Sometimes the foundations are shallow, maybe at a 1 meter depth. But many times the foundations are 2, 3, 4 meters deep. And in that case, pedestals play a very important role in terms of the overall behavior of the shed. Very, very important. So you should very clearly specify, like here specified, that it should be analyzed with the RCC column. So when you make a model in your software, you just simply don't model the PEB steel column and make it fix or pin at the base, but continue up to the RCC pedestal, up to the footing, and define that part as RCC, whatever size, define a pin or fix connection there at the joint, and then take the steel column. That will give you the correct behavior. Okay, and whether fix or pin, that is depending on the structure. All the experienced structural consultant, they know well where to fix, where to pin. Okay. Connection between steel and RCC column, rigid or hinge connection, whatever, that is to be defined. So all those analysis conditions should be mentioned here. Whatever the loads, live load on roof 75 as per Indian code. I'll come to that debate a little later. Whether Indian or MBMA or AS, I'll come to that. But if it is Indian, this one, and if the roof slope, Indian code allows a reduction in the load if the roof slope is more than a certain value. Normally, it is not that. Normally, we are less than that value. So normally, there is no reduction in the live load. But in the areas where snowfall is there, we cross that angle value and you can certainly use a reduced live load, but then there is a heavy snow load on that. Any other kind of load which is going to be there on the roof must be specified. HVAC, fall ceiling, pipe rack. In one of the projects for Disney World, there was 66 meter by 66 meter clear span shed which we were designing. And they say when we conduct the shows, we have to hang cameras, heavy lights, so many of other attachments from the roof. And you won't believe, the roof suspended load was 1 ton per meter square in that 66 meter by 66 meter clear span. So it was when we discussed with them that why you want the entire thing to be designed for this load. If you can specify the positions, only those things we can design. They said, no, there's not a fixed thing. We move them here or there. So that was a very challenging thing. But any such kind of thing should be defined here. Wind speed. This is basic wind speed as per figure 1 of IS 875 part 3. it should be specified. Rather than giving the location, it is better to specify the wind speed. Some people specify wind pressure. That's not correct. Design wind pressure is something very, very different, which you will calculate. Most of the consultants nowadays are aware. So you should specify the parameters. So basic wind speed, internal wind pressure. Do not leave this also to be decided by the PEB vendor. Specify that. Sometimes from the point of view of economy, some PEB vendors, they tend to consider plus minus 0.2. They consider building to be enclosed. But building to be enclosed means, if you read IS 875 part 3, very clearly mentioned, a building which is completely enclosed from all sides still have some openings here, such that plus minus 0.2 means less than 5% permeability is there. So it is very difficult to achieve plus minus 0.2 in a building where there are some door windows on the sides. So plus minus 0.5 is a rational value. If the buildings are open, like hangars, which are large opening on one side or both sides, then there will be certainly 0.8, plus minus 0.8. K1, K2, K3, K4 can also be specified. That is very good practice to be specifying seismic zone, which zone the building is. Now, crane details, deflection. This is something very debatable thing. But IS 875 part 3, IS 800 2007, table 1, gives quite clear values, and they should be used. Mostly they should be used. Else, such a table specifying the deflections in vertical, horizontal, in various load combinations should be included. Okay, refer table 6 of 800 deflection limit of other components. Miscellaneous design conditions, bracings, rod bracings not allowed, grade of steel. Sometimes we say the bidder can choose the grade of steel to provide most economical design. Sometimes, not always, this you can say that you are free. You can use 350, 450, 250 MPa, but we want the most economical. And there is nothing wrong in that, can be. But if you want to be specific, can do that also, the 350 or 450 or in some components you can go for 250, like heavy crane gantries, whatever components are under fatigue, a low strength steel performs better. Brazed bay, this is very, very important. How many brazed bay? Minimum 2 there should be, but if the length is longer, then as per IS 800 clause you can go on adding more number of brazed bays. And it will be further better if those brazed bay locations are marked on the tender drawings. The good practice is that it should be marked on the tender drawing that these are the brazed bays. So you can have the apple to apple comparison with everybody, all the vendors. Portal bracing. Sometimes you are having some restrictions because of some opening to provide the bracings in some ways. So their portal bracings can be provided, and it should be specified properly, the portal bracings. Increase of permissible stresses in case of dead end wind is not allowed. In case of dead plus wind is not allowed, because there the stability is the issue. Wind dominating. Flange braces shall be provided on both sides of the rafter. It depends. Some consultant may say one side alternately, depending on their analysis. Sometimes, but whatever provided, calculations can be asked for. Roof sheets and claddings, deflection to be checked as per 801. If some long spans are there, then this clause should be used. Stiffener in splice plate, these are the connection details. No advantage of a stiffener plate in design of a splice plate shall be permitted. These are the behavioral things. Rolling shutters, purlin spacing, how much you want, maximum, not more than 1.4. Column shall not be taken as braced by gantry girder supported on brackets. Yes, many people consider the gantry bracket or over with the gantry running as a column support in the lateral longitudinal direction, it is not correct. It should not be taken. Gantry girders, some specification about that. Rafters, if insulation is there. 12 mm dia hole in purlin every 1 meter center distance for hanging something. This is for hanging some lights or something. It may be, it is not necessary. This is general specification. Location of purlin junction. Which deck sheet to be used? Deck supporting beams, spacing. Procedure for the design drawing, checking and approval. And then erection specification should be there. Valuation of deviation, this is important. Whatever deviations are there, you must quote for these things. You must invite the quotation for these items if they change in the numbers or the tonnage. So there is no confusion at the later stage. These are the applicable codes, like AISC has been there. And this is the complete tender document, general tender document. But when this is converted to a particular building, so that goes as attachment, but this is the specification for the building. Bhavin, we are going on time track?
Yes, we are on time.
Hello?
Yeah, yes.
Okay. Hope I am not too fast.
No, it's perfectly fine, please.
So this sheet should have the project name at the top, then reference drawing number. You should mention the reference drawing numbers here. Coming down to the design code, if there is any change from the general specification, you should mention the codes here. So whatever is mentioned in this sheet supersedes information in the general specification document. Roof loading 75 or other, additional dead load, is the collateral load on the purlins or on the rafter, and 1 ton on each column means this is because of the cable tray. Cable tray load will directly come on the column as a point load. So that has been mentioned. Wind speed, internal pressure and earthquake zone is mentioned here. Crane as per drawing, all the specification regarding crane, regarding their height, the bracket height, regarding the span and the capacity and everything will be mentioned in the drawing. Where is the building is located? Roof slope 1 in 10 or one in ten is more common for the normal high rib sheeting with the joints overlaps. But nowadays, standing seam roofs are also used, and they are quite smooth and jointless. So slope as low as 1:20 is also used. The only thing is, if the spans are large, 1:20 leads to a heavier section of the rafters and column, because it practically becomes a beam kind of structure. It no more remains a portal, and so that becomes a complete horizontal spanning beam. Huge bending moments are there. Length out to out of brick wall. Now this is important. Where the brick wall is going to be placed, it should be very, very clearly mentioned in the drawing. Whether you want to put the brick wall outside the steel column, continuous brick wall, where you want to put the brick wall between the steel columns so that the brick wall and the steel columns are flushing outside, or sometimes people put the brick wall inside also, depending on the type of the industry. Whatever the requirement, it should be very, very clearly specified on the drawing. More elaborated drawing should be there. If you want some more sections, some more detail, blow up details to be made, do that. Never leave anything for the assumption. And all the PEB vendors, you must raise queries. The moment you receive the inquiry, raise queries. Have a deep study. That's very, very important. If you are providing the wall outside the steel column, there should be a clear gap of approximately 50 millimeter between the two. So that under the lateral forces, if the industrial shed column vibrates, moves little here or there, it does not lead to cracks in the brick wall. Leave a gap. We show the gap in the drawing. We make the brick wall 50 mm away. But when we do the plastering from inside, we fill that gap. And nobody is bothered about that. Nobody is bothered. Literally, I'm saying you. And that is where your all purpose of putting the wall outside is defeated. So make sure that there's a gap. If you are using a brick wall aligned with the steel column, then do proper detailing. It is very, very complicated how to plug that gap between the steel, how to properly connect the steel column with the brick wall. It should not be connected. It should remain separate. The brick wall should enter inside the flange. Do not touch the web up to the web. And then some kind of a packing should be used to seal the gap. The detail should be very clearly given. And whose scope? It should be defined. Clear height. There is eaves height inside measured from the floor. Frame type. Everybody knows about this. Clear space between the columns. It is as per the design. Drawing means. Crane, how many capacities? Bracket level. The bracket level of the crane, top of the crane rail. Make it very clear. What is this? Top of the crane rail, top of the gantry, whatever. It's not a standard practice, but generally top of the bracket you can also specify, or top of the gantry girder you can specify. That is more relevant, top of the gantry girder. Sidewall girds, either they are mounted on the exterior face of the column, or they may also be mounted flush with the outside of the column. If it is mounted on the outside of the column, then it is a continuous system and there is a horizontal beam. Or if it is inside, then there are individual spans. Okay. In the crane capacity, 8 number point, provision for future expansion of crane in bay 2 need to be taken. Sometimes, if you are making a building but not providing crane everywhere, so in the scope of the PB vendor, the crane gantry may not be there in the other bay, but its load is to be considered, so the provision should be there. Future expansion should be defined, what type. Brick wall, they should be shown on the drawing also, but should be generally written here. And what is the height? 2.7 meter high brick wall on three sides on FEW. Everybody understands FEW, front end wall and all those things, as per elevation. But you must very clearly specify. Now, while specifying this brick wall, should be very, very clear. Means when you decide as a process that what height of the brick wall is suitable, your rolling shutter should be accommodated, or your opening should be accommodated, or there should, if it is a warehouse, then at that level, whether there is a canopy or something. When you want to put the rolling shutter, then to support the rolling shutter box, you need to make some element there to, so that you can fix it, so that lintel over the brick wall will be of more depth. All those points should be very clearly understood and put on the drawing and specification. Framed openings, how many and where, they should be specified as per the drawing. Though many of the PB vendors have got a very good inquiry collection form. When they go to the consultant, they ask all the questions. They've got a very good format. So this should be able to give the sufficient information to the PB vendor marketing team, that they don't get any confusion and they get all the answers of their queries. Canopy as per drawing, whether the soffit is needed in the canopy or not. Very clear. We're on the bottom, how that is to be covered. Whether mezzanine is there or not, if there is a mezzanine, then details of mezzanine should be very clear. What is spacing of columns, what loading, imposed loading will be there. Some people even try to define the dead load of the mezzanine. You need not define the dead load of the mezzanine. There is something which your designer that itself will calculate. As per the live load, what section, what deck sheet, what concrete thickness will come. As per that, the dead load will be there. So specify only the live load on the mezzanine. Wind bracings, pipe or angle bracing. Column shape and base. This is again important. Column shape and base. If the columns are fixed base, then you can say that they are straight. If they are pinned base, you can say tapered. Base is fixed or pin, you can define. Sometimes even fixed base columns can be tapered. There's nothing like that. You can also have the fixed base column is tapered. Whatever base is available, the design can be done accordingly. It may not always be very, very economical, but sometimes it is required aesthetically or for some other purpose. Fascia is there or not, it should be shown in the drawing and in the specifications. Roof sheeting, what kind of roof sheets are there, whether sandwich puff panel are there or other. Daylight panels, there is a polycarbonate transparent sheet. Wall sheets of what category, what material. Deck sheeting, if mezzanine is there, then deck sheeting details would be there. Ridge vent is there or not. Roof monitor, ridge vent, turbo vent. These are some of the ventilation devices, and nowadays more are there. We have got these are the natural ventilations, ventilators, but there are nowadays mechanical forced ventilators are also there. If some industries need those to be hanged below from the roof, roof suspended, you can say air handling units are there. If they are there, then it should be specified so that they are considered in the design. Dwarka Convention Center, which is being made in Delhi, is a huge facility. There, from the roof, they are hanging some kind of an artificial funnel structures. Those funnel structures are very heavy, 8 meters by 8 meters, and half of them are projecting above the roof. So, their entire load is to be considered on the PV structure. So, they have to be, such a structure should be well defined in the drawings and all that. Turbo vents, if required, two numbers in each bay as per drawing, 600 mm dia. So, how many numbers and what type? Type is very important. Whether it's stainless steel, aluminium, or those fiber, whatever required. Accessories, details, fasteners, what kind of fasteners? What type of rainwater gutter would be there? Whether rectangular galvalume or GI, MS, what thickness? Depending on the nature, size of the shed, and this should be very properly worked out as per the rainfall. The traditional rainfall we used to consider for the design of the rainwater gutter and downtake pipe was 100 mm per hour. But nowadays, if you see, the rainfall pattern has changed. Nowadays, it is like catastrophic rains for a short duration of the time. Din mein ek ghante, do ghante, bahut tej barish aayegi, phir sara din nahi aayegi. Even in the rainy season. It may not happen even for 2-3 days, and then again suddenly there will be a downburst. So there are downbursts, there are catastrophic rains. So all the PV vendors, all my consultant friends, you should design the rainwater gutter and downtake pipes for a larger capacity. One, because the rainfall pattern has changed. Secondly, in India we are very casual about the maintenance of these sheds. See, before monsoon there should be a pre-monsoon maintenance carried out. आप लोग लिखते भी हैं बट नो बडी बॉदर्स अबाउट दैट. समटाइम्स रेन्स यू गेट इवन विदाउट द मॉनसून एंड एट दैट टाइम देयर इज लॉट ऑफ डस्ट डर्ट एंड ड्राई लीव्स एंड एवरीथिंग ऑन द शेड रूफ एंड ऑल दैट कम्स एंड स्टक इन द गटर एट रेन वाटर डाउन टू आउटलेट एंड देन देयर इज अ हैवॉक इनसाइड द प्लांट. मेनी वेयर हाउसेज आई सी वेयर देयर इज अ वाटर लॉक्ड एरियाज वाटर लीकेजेस इनसाइड इन ऑफ सीजन रेन्स बिकॉज ऑफ दिस प्रॉब्लम ओनली. सो बी वेरी केयरफुल about the rainwater gutter and downtake pipes. Painting, what kind of painting you want, properly specify what primer, how many coats, where to be done, whether in factory or on site, should be. If there are any structural partitions, define their location, type. If there are lowers, size and what kind of lowers, whether the lower should be with the bird mesh, without bird mesh, all those things should be. Coming down to the design parameters, pick software, you can specify. Many people use MBS or their own in-house some made packages. It's okay, there's no harm. The only thing is, when somebody else wants to check, they do not have those MBS or those in-house customized packages. So they need to get them checked on StatPro or ETABS kind of software, which are more commonly used. So all PV vendors should be ready with these things. The checking should be on the more common platforms, not their own. They can design, that's not an issue. Minimum thickness of plates can be specified, 5, 6, whatever. IS code doesn't say nowadays any minimum thickness of the plate. It's only the fire resistance criteria. Cold form sections, less than 1.75, sometimes people use 1.5 also, but for small spans it is okay. In cold farms, one more care should be taken in the construction, that how many number of bolts should be used, minimum number of bolts at the overlapping joints of the purlins and the runners. There is an overlapping joint at the top of the rafter and the columns. Many PV vendors, they use only two bolts there, which is not correct. So consultant should specify in the tender, minimum four bolts should be used or six bolts should be used on the overlapping joints. Steel line, for those who are clear with this, those who are not, steel lines means the from column to the external cladding distance, that is steel line. How much is that? It should be mentioned and it should also be shown in the drawing. Accordingly, the side runners, the girds shall be placed on bracket, extended clips and brackets. They'll be placed. And there's a cost for that. Right? Sometimes the steel line is as big as 1.2 meters, depending on the ventilation requirements. So huge brackets are used here. Crane data is there. Sometimes this crane data is not readily available at the time when the inquiry is sent, because the client has not finalized the type of the crane, the vendor. It is not okay to use the very heavy crane data. Though nowadays, earlier there used to be very, very heavy A1 crane manufacturer, used to be very heavy crane data. Nowadays, good cranes are available. So use a more commonly available crane type where, and specify in your quotation, you must specify that you have used this make crane data. If there is any significant change from this, there will be a variation in the tonnage and price. Be very clear. And it should be entertained well. Stress ratio. This is an important parameter of design. When you design in a software like STAT, it gives you the utilization ratio of every member. It should be less than 1. So 0.999 is also less than 1. And many people tend to design to minus 0.9999. See, every material, every component, every process is not 100% satisfactory, 100% qualified. But then you can argue that there are factors of safety. Yes, agreed, there are factors of safety. But code itself says design should be such that not more than 5% of the elements should fail. So 5% margin should always be there. So we recommend using not more than 0.95 as the stress ratio. Many government departments, when they specify in their tender, they say 0.8. It's their choice. The cost will automatically go up accordingly. But we recommend 0.95. Deflection limit. But this should be specified. This point should be specified. Deflection limits are there. Welding. So complete detail of the welding should be there. One side, two side, continuous, intermittent. If intermittent, then what length? Like 50 mm long stitches at every 1 meter center to center. For crane beams, full welding on both sides. All these things should be. Can we specify some?
Yeah, can you throw some light on fire rating also? It was mentioned.
Gray area. I'll come to that. It's a big gray area. A lot of debate has happened, and then there is one paragraph which has been added in IS 800 chapter 16, but yes, not much. But I'll discuss that.
Sure.
Yeah. We say submit work plan with your offer so that things are clear. Completion period like this. Proposal drawing. We are giving tender drawing, which are quite clear, but even then, what is the understanding of the vendor? So get a proposal drawing from that. Submit a declaration of confirmation to specs and drawing issued by us and deviations, if any. This is very important. When they submit, the consultant or the client should ask for acceptance of the specification tender document, signed copy. And if there are any deviations, it should be clearly mentioned that these are the deviations. Submit approximate tonnage breakup. This is only for the sake of comparison or clarity, understanding, because when we sit in a negotiation meeting, we try to understand where is the cost difference. But ultimately, price is not based on individual item. Plant visit, QA and workmanship. For this, we say a plant visit for client and consultant representative shall be included in your offer. It should be always done that a plant visit should be done to see the plant facility, capabilities, the testing done, organization, neatness, cleanliness, systems, the ownership, what is in-house, what is outsourced, to see all that. For a major project, this is very, very important. Which material you are using, what is the process of confirming and checking that, yes, you are using 345 MP or some other. These things for this plant visit should be done. And not once, two at least plant visit should be done. One before starting the project, and second is when the production is going on. Make available anchor bolt GA and fabrication drawing at the plant during inspection. Generally, only fabrication drawings are there at the plant, and the plant people are not at all aware that which this component is, means in the overall building. And the person who is going to visit, if he is not carrying GA, then it is very difficult sometimes to correlate the things. Your quality assurance plan and checklist for production and erection shall be submitted. This is very important, and QA plan should be properly seen, checked of their past projects also for any PEB vendor. In not this one, in past you must have done some project where there is a record of the QA. Just show that how you are, and where were the defects or deviations and how you corrected them. Some more points toward the end, and then performance bank guarantee like this. So this is a customized specification for a particular building. From my side, these are the presentations. One more is there, which is for a multi-story building, but right now I'm not touching that. We can go to the discussion.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, just a bit. So already you touched many points related to the queries what we received. So during when we announced this event, we requested participants to share their queries in advance. So many points which they raised. So already you touched upon it briefly, but can we scroll through very quickly the questions?
Yes.
We have more discussion on this. Yeah. The first question which was coming, you know, in from all the participants, that was related to American code based practice, whether it is allowed as per Indian codes, and what is the liability of a structural engineer, let's say found guilty practicing American codes and not BIS code in case of a failure mishap. So I'll just quickly read out 3-4 more points which I've just picked up from the participants. One is
I have read them, and I'll just answer. Okay. In one, all these things.
Okay.
Dear friends, how many participants we have right now joining this session?
Yeah, right now it is 78.
Good. Yeah. Friends, this is a big question. I'll give an example. I go to market to purchase a product. Say it is a toothbrush. And on the shop, there are hundreds of toothbrush displayed. It is my choice. I pick any toothbrush. No one is going to stop me. I'll bring that home and start using that. Whatever are the consequences of that are solely my responsibility. No one in that shop forced me to buy a particular toothbrush. Whether I purchased an ISI marked or an imported one or a no marker toothbrush or a bamboo toothbrush, wooden toothbrush or other toothbrush. It is totally the control or choice of the person who is paying. The flexibility, the choice is available. Similarly, in the PEB industry or in building industry or in any industry, the supreme person is the one who is paying the client. The client, if wants, I want my building to be designed for such and such parameter. Nobody can say why. Nobody can ask a question. Do you know, on Indian roads, when a vehicle is allowed to run, when it is allowed to have registration, it has to pass through a test. It has to pass through a complete screening of the Transportation Ministry, which checks the vehicle suitability for running on the road. Besides other aspects, safety of the driver and safety of the other people. Any hazardous vehicle cannot be allowed to run on the road. Similarly, any hazardous product cannot be sold. Similarly, any hazardous building cannot be constructed. Now, whether that hazard is because of the owner, whether that hazard is because of the consultant, whether that hazard is because of the supplier. Anyone who is found to create that hazard is guilty. Now coming down to the codal practice. In India, we should use Indian code provisions, IS code provisions. Why? IS code provisions have been made after thorough debate, after detailed study of several experiments and analysis for Indian conditions. Material which is available in India, material which is produced in India, the workmanship which is there in India, the maintenance which is there in India, according to that, the construction code has been, the design code has been written. So, when the question is there, whether I can use American code-based practice or MBMA because it is cheaper, there can be a cheaper product from other country. But it can be toxic. It can be hazardous. It can be threat to life of many people. So, as long as the client says, I want to use American code for my building design, and he dictates and the consultant agrees and designs it and vendor supplies, and the building is erected and nothing wrong is happening with the building. Till the date nothing wrong is happening, till the date the building is performing well, no legal complications are there and nobody can put a question. Because I wanted this, so I got this. The day that building undergoes some damage, some accident, some collapse in a natural hazard, wind or earthquake, then entire thing would be analyzed and then there would be a legal question that how this permission of a building which is inferior to Indian code practices is given. Do you know that? In metro, several accidents happen, metro construction. But till date, no consultant has been accused, only for one reason, that they followed all the provisions of the code of practice. In pre-engineered buildings, workmanship is mostly okay. You are using a standard product from factory, tested, consistent quality product. The only chance of a defect in the construction is joint. The nut bolt tightening, the bracings. Material is all okay. So if the design is found to be inferior than IS code, then yes, there is a liability. The liability is on whom? Liability is on both the structural consultant and the owner. Because they dictated the inferior specifications, not of the PEB vendor. The vendor will supply what you say. That is where we need to make our clients aware that if somebody is saying, there's another aspect of that. Many PEB vendors, they try to teach the client that if I design a building using American code, it will be cheaper. Why in India an American code design building? Why? Then why don't we give a mandate to the country that whatever is available cheapest in the world should be implemented in India? We don't do that. We don't do the same thing in the IS code 456, concrete buildings. We don't do that. There are several provisions which are not available in 456, or several provisions which are different. Particularly with respect to the earthquake resistant detailing, if you see, we are using a closed loop ring with 135 degree angle, whereas the same in ACI is permitted to be double U ring. There are many other practices. They allow dowel bars from the beams, from the footings. We don't have those provisions in our code. So we don't use them. On concrete side, we use everything as per IS 456. Then why on the steel building? Because steel building practice in India has come in a very different manner. I was discussing with Bhavin in the beginning that steel building practice in India has come the way first the building has come. Directly the pre-engineered building PEB term has come. And then some specification was taught later on after long. Even engineers were trained by the vendor. We all, most of us say, even many of the clients, they say, I want a Kirby building. Similar to Dalda Ghee. Many of you may remember that the Vanaspati Ghee, which was available long back in a yellow colored tin with a coconut tree on that, Dalda named, we all thought that Dalda Ghee means it's a variety of the ghee. We never thought that Dalda is a brand. Now we know that Dalda is not a brand. Dalda is a brand. But Vanaspati Ghee, and several other variants are there. Same thing with many other products. So when the product comes first and becomes very popular without defining its specification, then product is named by the first introducer, Kirby Buildings. Pre-engineered buildings in India are more commonly known as Kirby buildings, and for that Kirby should be proud of. But Kirby did not do one good thing. If anybody from Kirby is listening, they should have taken an initiative to define a set of specification as per Indian condition. They should have supported, they should have provoked a proper design practice for such kind of buildings. Whatever Kirby was doing has become the practice. And till date, there is a little change in that. Little change. There's a PEB Manufacturer Association, I believe, in the country. But it doesn't do anything. Literally doesn't do anything. Everybody is just busy in selling the building. And there are incidences where accidents happen. So friends, in India, use Indian code. People use Indian wind code. They say we are using IS 875 for wind speed. It's not the wind speed only. When you convert the wind speed to wind pressure, design wind pressure, there are several factors. They use those factors from some other booklet like MBMA. But they don't know that MBMA is nothing but Metal Building Manufacturer Association manual. It's a manual made by a particular product-oriented people who wanted to sell their buildings. So their procedures are not applicable to India. Their coefficients cannot be applicable. We are using a 3-second gust wind speed. They are using 10 minutes. Somebody is using hourly mean wind speed. How can their pressure coefficient CPE and CPI be same as Indian? It's a different thing. So when you use IS 875, because wind in India is Indian wind. I cannot have American wind here. Earthquake in India is Indian earthquake. So all the parameters have to be Indian parameters. So when the loads are concerned, you have to calculate the entire load as per Indian code. And when the design comes, use IS 875. Some people say, no, the building with IS 875 are heavy. Why you consider them to be heavy? They're rational as per Indian condition. Ek kapda jo India mein achha perform karta, because we have a tropical climate, we have quite a hot and humid environment and different kind of thing. The same cloth cannot perform well in European atmosphere. It cannot. हमारे यहाँ बाहर निकलते हैं धूप आती है पसीना आता है ढेर सारी गंदगी. We have to wash the cloth every second day, third day. दो बार पहनने के बाद में वहां पे होती ही नहीं डस्ट एंड दे आर यूजिंग लॉट ऑफ वूलन्स एंड वार्म क्लॉथ्स एंड अदर थिंग्स. सो हाउ कैन वी कंपेयर? वी कैन नॉट. अवर बिल्डिंग्स हैव टू सस्टेन अवर एनवायरमेंट एंड मेंटेनेंस. There you go and see the European and American buildings, PEB buildings. Their gutter size and downtake pipe size are too small, and even then they don't face any problem of the overflow because they have proper maintenance. In India, एक बारिश में पूरा overflow हो जाता है, अंदर पूरा भर जाता है पानी. Workmanship, सारे joint हमारे living apart, maybe few PEB vendors who do good work, but I have seen. Our workmanship is not that good. Poor. I literally say poor. Because on sites, PEB vendors do not put a qualified person, proper engineer. एक project engineer होगा वो चार site देखता है. Erector के जिम्मे होती है site और वो क्या alignment करता है और क्या लगाता है. Few buildings are made very good. I am not saying that all are bad. But the practice, common practice. That is why IS code should be followed. So friends, do not entertain any such request of American. Or if at all a client says, मैंने सुना है ऐसा, make him aware, sir, दोनों में फर्क है. फिर भी आप कहोगे American में कर दूंगा, लेकिन दोनों में फर्क है, ये फर्क है. Like this. So friends, my advice is use IS code for everything. And if there is a failure, yes, we will be held guilty.
Yes. So next few, yes. Few questions were in the same line.
No. Like, straight answer, no.
Yes. This no. We have discussed. Yes.
Not at all matching. What is this question? Yes, man, go back.
Yeah.
Go back. Vaidyanathan, what is this question? No, Vaidyanathan's question. The next one.
Just a minute.
Yes. What is your take on MBMA with Indian wind loading? They are two different things. MBMA 2006 is not a code, it is a manual. Manual design drafted. It is not design, it is a written document for some different country. How, what can be the take on Indian wind load there? See, be rational. We are engineers. Be rational. Next.
Yes. Yeah, it is again in the same line. We have discussed.
Please, yeah, I hope I have answered this.
You have already answered it. Yeah, Abhishek, yes. Is like,
Abhishek, basically, jack beams are not a good solution, but they are unavoidable in some situation. When we cannot have, when we want a large opening, at that place, we avoid a particular column. And when the column is avoided, the roof rafter has to be supported on a beam running in the direction, and that beam we call as jack beam. Providing jack beam is absolutely okay if properly analyzed. If you make a proper 3D model and over that you model the rafter and over you model also the jack beam. Many people design the jack beam like they will model and at the point of support where the rafter is supported on the jack beam, they will define a support. And then reaction of that support they will apply on the jack beam in a separate model and then they will design. It is wrong. Because jack beam itself will undergo a horizontal and vertical both deflections. So it is better, or it is rather correct, to model the jack beam also in the 3D model with the proper stiffness, and then it is okay. Absolutely, there is no problem in using a jack beam, means alternate columns avoided, and the grid spacing, if it is 8 meter, then using a 16 meter jack beam. Decreasing the base spacing, if it is feasible, it is okay. If it is not, then jack beam has to be provided.
Yeah.
Hope I have answered, Abhishek.
Yes.
Huh?
Yeah. This for wind gutters.
It is very important to specify where the wind gutter system is required structurally and according to the utilities and wall opening should be planned. Yes, I explained this during the tender itself. That's drawing. We should mark in the drawing where the wind bracing should be there. It should not be left to the vendor.
Yes.
In the same way, my experience says that there should be one wind gutter system at approximately every 50 meter. Okay. That's, you are perfectly okay. And every frame is at 8 meters and every 7. That's very good. Minimum two bracings should be there. And as the length increases, this is correct, then approximately 50 meter you can have one.
Yes.
Minimum very basic wind speed before the water to PB vendor, the client must specify the eave's height requirement clearly. Very necessary. Mm. All these geometrical parameters should be clearly defined.
Mm.
Actually, clients, we should not put a blame on the clients. Except 10%, 90% clients are unaware. 10% clients have their in-house engineering, so they understand. But 90% of the clients, they depend on PB vendors. They will straight away get one. They will write down the requirement. I want this big size of the shed. Ye crane chahiye, aisa chahiye, and they will call some PB vendor and give it the requirement. Phir once that PB vendor submits a quote, that quote without price, they will send to some other PB vendor and get another quote for comparison. That's not a good practice. So we should make aware all our clients that this is not. Means continue to write. The most important thing is not only consultants, even PB vendors. You should write your experiences on various platforms. You should publish your stories of the good project on various platforms and emphasize that these were the good things and of the specification, of the tender stage, of the construction, of the consultant involvement, that the project could be done better. So that the client read and make good use in future.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Many PB vendors provide continuous roof for a very long span, which is ludicrous. Roof should be given a break point and the adjacent roof after the break point should be the same slope. Could not understand, Abhishek, you are talking of longitudinal or cross? You mean to say if suppose my shed is 50 meter wide, I am using a 50 meter wide portal. If my shed is 100 meter wide, rather than using a 100 meter wide portal, I should use two of 50-50.
Yeah, let him write in the chat box. Then we can move to the next point till that
okay. Time. I found the PB vendor design file support and supported in the column about manners is considered as GERT center dimension. This is okay if the girds are, if the column flange, the compression flange of column is braced properly with the girds. That is where in our specification we clearly say that the column flanges should be braced. So those bracings should be there from the girt on both sides. Flange, the compression flange of column should not be allowed to laterally move. I think in one of your lectures, Bhavin, lateral torsional buckling, probably.
Yes, yeah.
Explain this also.
Yes, it was called. Yes.
On gable wall at junction of column and rafter, lateral force perpendicular to rafter minor axis is generated. Yes. In conventional design, we provide the member at that location and transfer force to bracing through tie. But in PB design, no any ties are provided at this junction and purlins are not designed to take axial load generated at the junction. Kindly share with us. Actually, either the wind bracing would be there in the first bay or the second bay. If it is in the first bay, then this force directly goes to the wind bracing. If it is in the second bay, then there should be member. There should be some member at each such a point where the gable and column is meeting the rafter, there should be one horizontal member connecting the roof rafter to the second point on the second roof rafter where the wind bracing is starting. By doing so, you will ensure that the gable and wind on the top end of the gable and columns is properly transferred to the wind bracing system. It should be transferred to the wind bracing system, no doubt. And you are very correct that purlins are not being considered for that. Either you check the purlins that they are transferring. It should be. On gable wall at junction, ho gaya, what shall be unsupported length for torsional buckling of purlin, center to center of support or center to center of sag rod? Sag rod, center to center of sag rod is okay provided the end of the sag rod is properly held in position. Only then. And if all the sag rods are properly tied. Otherwise, better to have, because if you take the center to center of the purlin support, it will be too heavy a purlin, too heavy. So sag rod is considered, but then sag rod should be properly tightened with the purlin at two points, the top and bottom, and then at the end also. So the end is rigid, the eaves gut. I hope I have been able to explain the behavior.
Yes.
In PEB, bracings are considered as tension member only. Is this correct method? Yeah, it is correct. That's not an issue. Bracings, tension member only. The only thing is slenderness ratio of tension member, which will convert to the compression by change of the wind load direction, should be properly considered. That slenderness ratio should be used. PEB column sizes are so slender that they provide purlin as the tie during construction stage. In case of cyclone, is these structural amenities sufficient? No, it is not. And it should not be the purlin only which should be used. There should be temporary guy ropes, wire ropes, bracing should be used to hold the entire structure in position, as long as it is not fully, you can say, completed with rest with the bracings and all that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, okay, you should use the bracings, wire ropes.
Yeah. So, meanwhile, Abhishek has confirmed that this is along the shorter direction of the building.
Okay, you are perfectly okay.
Yeah.
You should not use a continuous single roof because it will be too high and all that. It should be broken. The only problem with splitting into smaller sizes that you get a valley gutter in the middle. And treating a valley gutter has been a pain. Has been a pain. Valley gutters have become the point of the leakage and all that. So if the valley gutters can be properly made and dealt from eaves towards the ridge, the roof can be given a break and raised for a 150 meter frame span. Eaves to roof can be given a break and raised. But then again, there will be a gutter in the middle. That gutter in the middle is the issue.
Yes.
Even in the this kind of configuration. See, all possibilities are there. You are probably indicating towards a multi-span roof as given in IS code. That is same thing. No? Multi-span roof, if you see the diagram, it is north light kind of the arrangement. That is okay, but it's not very common now because of the valley gutter issues. But if it is 150 meter wide, I have recently worked on a 230 meter wide and was a continuous 230 meter, means 115 meter on each side, only for this reason. But the only thing is then huge gutters were there, huge. Slab on grade. Slab on grade should always be designed for localized pressure and settlement. A proper wrinkler model should be prepared. Then we have several lot of ground slab caused by this method. Actually, though this is not a point of the PEB, but of the industrial shed flooring, what you are saying is very correct. Proper Winkler model should be there. Nowadays, innovative use of the fibers is there. Very good flooring systems are there, and which save a lot of cost and all that. The only thing is, any kind of flooring you use, concrete, whatever good, if your subgrade and subbase is not good, it will not survive. So proper attention should be given to preparation of the subbase and subgrade, and it should be well compacted and all that. If that is not good, your grade slab is not going to perform well. Okay, one more point related to this I would like to say. In our specifications, we also mention the level of the base plate. That is the reference level, the level of the base plate. There are two practices. One practice is to keep the base plate top same as the FFL. In that case, the anchor bolts are projecting up and you can see them, correct? There is another practice where the bottom of the base plate is taken 300 mm below the FFL. And when they are taken 300 mm below the base plate, then the surrounding is encased into the concrete, the stiffeners and the bolts all are encased into the concrete. While doing the flooring, there is a joint cut all around. So because of the structure movement, no further crack is developed. And then that gives a very good, clear, smooth finish of the floor. So generally nowadays we prefer to keep the bottom of the base plate of PB column as 300 mm below the FFL and then encase into the concrete. That is what I wanted to put. But regarding grades, Abhishek, what you're saying is very correct. Not in the scope of the PEB vendor, but on the industrial flooring side, sometimes we may have a session on industrial flooring. It's a whole subject. Nowadays, so many varieties of the industrial flooring are available. And these, because of the development of the warehousing industry, there is a huge requirement in the country of the industrial flooring. Huge requirement of variety, of floor finishes, different type of densifications, hardeners, so many things are there. So maybe Bhavin can arrange a special session on industrial flooring only with some industrial expert, not me, but somebody.
Sure.
Construction and contraction joint is 11, again, same thing.
Same point, yeah.
But this is very important.
Yes.
Designing the roof slope with regard to available rainfall data and hence designing the number of downspouts. This I explained.
Yes, you explained.
Yeah, it is most neglected. They design it 100 mm per hour and invariably it overflows. Invariably.
Yes.
Section 12 as per IS 800.
Yeah.
As far as
can we just give the brief to the audience that now NBC is is the updated document, because I think majority of the people would not be aware about it.
Yeah, because it has not been implemented, means the new version of 800 has not come, so better to use NBC. NBC section 6, section 12 as per IS 800. For small buildings, actually section 12 is important from the earthquake point of view, and since most of your industrial structures are not earthquake governing, they are wind governing, so this can be avoided for industrial buildings where multiple levels of mezzanines etc. are not there. There are simple one single story sheds are there of whatever size. This section 12 can be avoided. Roofing fasteners lead to corrosion failure and challenges that affect the building. Nowadays, such good fasteners are available in roof that corrosion is not at all there. Corrosion is not there. The problem is different. Leakage is due to there because of the workmanship issues. Otherwise, roof sheeting fasteners are not the source of the leakage. Unless and until they are removed once and refixed and, or something else is attached to them, like lifeline ropes, safety railings, those things are also fixed without proper. Even solar panels, if proper arrangement of solar panels is not there, then those become the leakage points. So otherwise, corrosion is not there in the roofing fasteners. So at tender stage, if the correct fasteners are specified, yes, it should be. Good make should be there. And there are more points in that. Best quality fasteners for contractors and labor costs, and for them it makes sense. More than 70% roofing fasteners sold in India. Okay. So all fasteners.
Yes.
Good fasteners are available, no doubt. Software for PEB design. We are using STAD only. Very good. And STAD PlanWin is there, which helps you to customize. There are very good options available with the STAD Pro. But there are other also. I'm not saying that others are not. We are using STAD Pro. Provision of bracing, portal bracing. Yes, explain this.
Yeah, we have covered.
Stitching of wind column, both ends spin, top and bottom, designed for the wind pressure. Expansion joint in PEB building. Beyond 180 meter, you should provide. If number of bracings are there enough, then 240 meter as per IS 800. So expansion joint should be there. The only thing is expansion joint on the roof. Columns you can have two separate. In the roof system, the purlin should have a sliding joint. Sheeting should have the overlapping, much more overlapping with the sliders. That is the thing. But expansion joint in PEB buildings should be there. Tony Rose is from?
He's from Zamil probably.
Okay.
Yeah.
connection design, base plate design. If you have any specific query, you can ask, but I'll not be able to teach connection design and base plate design here.
I think point was regarding that these connection design philosophy also should be included or not in a tender stage.
No, not. They are very standard things. As per IS 800.
Yes. Section 10 of IS 800, yes.
Yeah.
This we have.
Calculation parameters. All parameters K1, K2, K3, K4, KA, KD, KC should be defined in the tender itself. Yes. Do not leave anything for the vendor. Internal permeability, define it. Wind speed, define it. Everything. Mm. Number of wind bracings, show on the drawing. Fire rating requirement of PBs. See, Ajay Deepak Sutarji. Hello, Deepak. Actually, fire rating requirement of PB structure is same as any other industrial building. However, IS 800 does not say much about fire rating. If you look at the chapter 16, the first paragraph, earlier there was no statement. Now they have included that in the NBC. It may not be in the 800, it is in the NBC steel section, that the fire rating should be, in general, the steel structures are not good fire resistant, and for increasing the fire rating, measures like intumescent coating, passive or active fire rating coating should be used. Only this much has been written there. And then there is a calculation. If you use that calculation, a building designed using IS 800 just shows 15 minutes of fire rating according to that calculation. So, in any industrial building, in any steel building, you have to use an additional fire rating, fire protective device. However, in industrial building, if the fire producing area is confined to some limited zone, if that zone is cordoned off, then the building need not be made fire rated. If there is a storage of hazardous material, then the building should be fire rated using the intumescent or vermiculite or some fire rated board. It should be. So that's an industrial safety requirement. As such, with the IS 800, there is no separate requirement specified that a steel building should have minimum 2 hour or 4 hour fire rating. It is not there, like in the RCC code. It's not there.
Yeah, this we have covered.
Can be avoided for single story industrial buildings. Minimum thickness of primary element like rafter, column, secondary element like sheeting. I have already specified in this specification sheet. Generally, yeah, 5 mm by 7.5 with you.
Yeah. Yeah, so these were the few questions which we picked it up from the participants. Now, there are a few queries coming up in the live chat. So, let's take 2-3 queries and then we can close the session, right? Yeah. Okay. Abhishek Singh has told that single side welding, what you touched upon. So, he said it is permitted by AWS T1.1 and it is allowed many times in India as per his experience. So, is it wrong?
It is wrong as per Indian practice.
Yes.
When there is IS 816, which specifies the plate girders, it should be used. However, people are using AWS and it is performing.
Hmm.
Because if you weld only on one side, I don't know whether anybody has tested any time, but a web to flange welding on one side only means an eccentric connection, and how it will perform under a loading, under the bending and all that, it should be tested. It has not been checked anywhere. If somebody can take up a project in IIT or some other institution.
Yes. Deflection criteria in Indian codes are stringent than AISC or British codes. So that's what you explained, like why it is stringent.
It should be. Why it should not be.
Yes.
See, in Indian conditions, we cannot allow many things which are similar to other country codes. But I don't think Indian code criteria are stringent. We need to understand them well. if you look at the table, it says deflection under live imposed load. That table is for imposed load only. So it is over and above the self weight.
Yes.
And then there is a provision of plastic design. If you start using the plastic design, limit state design for the steel structure, our designs as per IS code would be lighter than, I'm sure, than AISC or maybe at par.
Right.
We all should learn the limit state design.
Yes. Yeah, this is a question from Akash that if it is mentioned in the tender that previous experience is required, considering the complexities involved, then for a new design consultant in the PEB industry, how should one begin getting projects?
No, this previous experience is for PEB vendor, not for the consultant.
Yes.
In India, unfortunately, there is no experience required for any consultant to take up any work. Only the clients may sometimes define, I want this. But otherwise, legally, it is not required. Legally, neither this nor even this is required, that to start a construction practice or to continue, you should continuously upgrade your knowledge. You should undergo certain number of training programs, continuous education courses. Nothing is required. I'll share sometimes one of my article, which is widely published, how a human being can die. Aap log search kar sakte hain Google pe, how a human being can die. If you get that article, read it. I have tried to highlight this point.
Yeah, Ganesh has put up this point that if building has a deck slab, so can we design primary and secondary beam laterally supported beam?
Deck slab, can we design primary and secondary beam? See, laterally, primary beams would be supported by the secondary beams. Lateral support. And secondary beams, if the deck sheet is properly fastened over that secondary beam, then the lateral support can be considered.
Yeah, your views on providing hairpins at RCC pedestal, RCC slab junction to transfer horizontal load to slab to reduce the foundation design?
It can be, then you have to design and construct accordingly. This is okay. I don't see any difficulty in this.
Yes. Yeah, like as we have used very ideal type of support conditions or releases specs at a member design in software, then are there any risk of under designing any element?
See, as long as whatever you are assuming, whatever you are conceptualizing, whatever you are modeling, if you are able to make the same in the field, or whatever is being made in the field, you are able to model, then there is no risk. The risk is only when you assume something like this and it doesn't happen that way.
Right.
I got an ETAPS file from one of the consultant where I'm doing the proof checking. All the columns of a multi-story building at the foundation level, he pinned RCC columns. He defined them as pinned columns. Now, I was surprised how I can get a pinned RCC column at the top of a raft. How can we make it? Very difficult. Not possible. So, as long as you're able to achieve.
Yes.
Stability of PB structure which lies with the structural consultant or PB contractor. Could not understand, Nilesh.
No, so what I think he's trying to ask, let's say PB vendor is issuing stability certificate. So the responsibility lies with structural consultant or PB contractor. I think that is what he's trying to ask.
Yeah. See, it lies with both. The certificate which is being issued by PB vendor should be reviewed by the consultant. The format may need to be included few more parameters. We give our parameter to all the PEB vendor that your stability certificate should be in this format. Okay. And then they sign and we also issue that endorsed by us.
Yes.
Because the PEB vendor will certify that the building has been constructed as per the design given to him. if they are not designing. So the design responsibility lies with us.
Yeah, Arun Kumar is asking, is it acceptable to follow? Yeah, answer is no. Yes. Okay. And Abhishek is asking that in India, I don't know why PV vendors don't erect braced frame first. Can Professor Abhay sir so throw some light on this?
No, they erect braced frames first. They will erect, if suppose not the first, they will keep them tied with the guy ropes or some kind of temporary bracing till the braced frame is erected. Without that, no PV vendor will take a risk. It is their own risk. Yes. It is their own risk. And I'll appreciate most of the PEB vendors, their erection teams are aware of this.
Okay, so already we have closed, reached to 12:45. And still I the comments are coming up. So we can request all participants to later on. When this video will be published on YouTube, they can still write their comments on the YouTube. Sure. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Dr. Abhay Gupta, for sharing your important points. Yeah. And thank you all for participating in this important discussion. Okay. Have a nice day ahead. Okay. Bye from our side. Bye.
Bye-bye. Take care. Bye.